for them. Not only that, they compare themselves to HBO. And HBO came in 1970s. In 1980s, they went into original content programming. It was 14 years later that they picked up their first Emmy. They had got that in their first year. So it's not just commercial success, it was a remarkable success otherwise as well. How can I create value? I'll speed up a little bit because I'm running out of time. But I'm sure this man is famous, Alan Greenspan. The quote is not exactly his. I tried to reduce that a bit. You know the typical Alan Greenspan quotes. Goes across 5 pages, and I can't really read and understand it, so I just try to summarize it. But here's what he's saying. If you know whether people are fearful or euphoric, you can predict economy much better. And he says that there's no way that I can do that, unfortunately. But that was in 2007. But somebody from Stanford picked that up, and then they did some analysis. Now they can do that. You can look at blogs, and you look at tweets, and then you can create something called as an anxiety index. You can read those things. You can mark that. This is a standard machine learning practice. Supervised learning, because it's you're manually labeling them. And the graph doesn't show it very well, but what happens is that they predict that 2 days ahead, you can predict the stock market whether it go up or down based on the anxiety index, right? So what people did was that in 2011, a lot of people started what these companies are called Twitter funds. One was a deuster in London, where they started a company called Absolute Returns. They call it the Twitter Fund. Unfortunately, the financial people are a fickle bunch, and they're very conservative kind of people. You go and tell them that we'll start a company based on Twitter, that's not really going to fly. The company went down. So you have to ask the how question, how do I sell that? The fact or the matter is that as of now, about 40% of all trading that happens in London Stock Exchange happens in black box systems, predictive models. But they don't just go and announce that it's Twitter Funds. It's successful, but you have to sell it the right way. Last few slides, how do I sell it in my firm? This was a question. So I have this great idea. I think it's wonderful for my firm. How do you sell it? My suggestions, these are several recommendations, what worked for me and what I would say would work for you, my guess. Focus on the strategy, focus on the culture. First was the strategy, right? So choose your fights. Usually, and we'll talk about that in the three more slides, fourth slide is my last one. You'll see that if you're investing in an analytic platform, it takes some time before you see the results. And usually that time is anywhere from 2 to 3 years. That's a long time. And if you're invested like $15 million to it, your CFO will come back and question you and say, show me the money, show me the returns. And then you won't have anything to show. So start small. Don't invest huge amounts because people will come and ask you. If they do, at least make sure that you tell them about the timelines and make sure that they're happy about it, right? Surely wins for the same reason. You don't want somebody to be waiting for 2 years before they see the results. Have a laser sharp focus. And finally, align to company goals. A lot has to be aligned to your company. If your company's focus is on sales, align to something in sales. If your company is majorly invested, or if your company's majorly expenses coming from logistics, see how you can put analytics in logistics. Because you have to go for somewhere where there is impact. Peter Drucker famously said, culture eats strategy for breakfast. You can have the best strategy, but unless it aligns your company culture, you are wired to fail. You will fail because your company will reject it. Your people will reject it. Develop a culture of sharing. When I say sharing, I mean data, right? Make sure your marketing team talks to your sales team. Your sales team talks to your operations team. Your operations team talks to your service team so that the data is in sync. You'll be surprised. You'll be surprised to know how many companies are not in sync. They don't talk to each other because they're worried. They don't want to share the data. Even among the same company, in the same company, among the same business. Make everyone win. So when they share the data, and if you're an IT wing which is doing the analytics, will you add them to your glory when you win? You have to, otherwise they have no incentive to share the data. Have skin in the game. So this is mainly about line of businesses, right? Usually when you want to invest, the insights that you get from investing in analytics is going to the line of businesses. They are the people who are to implement the actionable insights. And if they're not invested in it in terms of money, they're not that motivated to do it, right? So make sure they have skin in the game. Last two slides, get great people. This quote is from Steve Jobs, and Steve Jobs is usually very, very crisp. Unfortunately, this is where he was a little verbose. It was a television interview, but here's a summary of it. He says, works for New York, but could work for you as well. Let's assume that you have the best cab driver ever in Bangalore, and then you have just another average cab driver, right? How much would be the difference in results if you're driving to one particular destination? He says in a place like New York, works for Bangalore, could be not more than 30%, right? So there's, if the best cab driver costs 5 times more, probably there's no reason to have the best cab driver. But in terms of knowledge workers, a huge difference, and he says that difference could be 50-1 or even 100-1. The impact a team makes. Predictive analytics doesn't need 300 people. I've not seen many companies who have that kind of people, and it's not required as well. You can start with 10 people, but make sure they are superstar people. And be patient. We talked about this. We said, look at Facebook. So Facebook started in 2004. Look at 2004 to 2006 data. Mighty Facebook was not able to add that many people in the first 3 years. I mean, after 3 years, they would have probably shut down and said, okay, only 12 million users. I don't think this is going to scale. Let me go home. Why am I giving it free? But they were patient. They knew that. And that's the same story with most ventures where you accumulate data. Where does the power of Facebook come from? The users, but also the data about the users so they can show them the right stuff. You have to be patient for the data to accumulate, and then you can show remarkable results. The same way, look at iTunes, for example. When it started in 2004, between 2004 to 2007, it was very, very slow. The progress was very slow. In fact, till about 2010, there are a total of about 10 billion downloads of songs, right? And from there, from 2010 to the next 18 months, happened the next 10 billion. It's all about building that platform. It's all about having that vision to take that platform to the next level, when it becomes that next 10 billion. Thank you. I hope this has been useful. My email number is email ID is there. Your feedback, suggestions, I would like to interact with you outside as well as over email. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Robin.
Thank you.
A small token of appreciation for Robin. An applause. Thank you.
Thank you.
So for the next slot, before we break for another tea coffee break, so we have Mr. Vijay Srinivas, who will take you to the next session. And meanwhile, spare a couple of minutes, we'll just set up the machine for him.
So the idea is to take you through some of the current work, which is probably state of the art in AI and big data, is what I would call it. So let's look at some of the where it came from and This thing doesn't work. Should I point it somewhere, or where am I pointing? Okay. Now I'll do it here. This doesn't work. Oh yeah. Okay. All right. Got it. Yeah. Okay. So just to give a brief intro to some of the concepts, I'll just talk about a little bit about the basics of artificial neural networks. So the basic thing is called a perceptron. So perceptron, the way it works is each of the inputs, there's also a weighted connection. So A multiplied with the weight and added with B multiplied by its weight. And then finally, all this is compared against a threshold. And based on if it is greater or lesser, the neuron or the perceptron, either it fires or it does not fire. So this is the very basic concept of a perceptron. Now the point is what we are trying to do is to figure out, you know, if there is small change in the input, how does the output also change? Whereas a perceptron doesn't lend itself for that because it's like a binary, it only fires or does not fire. So if you make a small change, then it could change, and it basically flips the output, right? So what you want is something slightly different, so which is why people use what's known as a sigmoid neuron. So that is the function here. So essentially it's like a smooth function as opposed to the step function, which was the perceptron. So the smallest unit which people talk about is this sigmoid neuron, right? So just to get a feel for what exactly is an ANN and how things are combined, right? So we'll start with one of the, it's like a very simple perceptron kind of thing, but can anyone guess what this is? It's like a perceptron, two input inputs are there, so the X1, X2 could be 0 or 1, and the weights are -2 and -2, and the threshold is 3. So for example, if X1 and X2 are 0 and 1, right? So then it will be -2, which is less than 3, so the neuron will not fire. And the other case is, for example, if it is 1, both are 1s, right? It will be -4, which is greater. So things like that, right? Essentially, we just have to figure out, based on the inputs, is it going to fire or not? So what is this? It's just a NAND gate, right? Very, very basic form of a NAND gate. So why did I put this up? The idea is that the by combining, so what we are talking about is just one perceptron or a sigmoid neuron or whatever, right? Now the power doesn't come in, you know, the single entity by itself, but when it's actually combined with lot of such entities, that's when it gets the real power. So that's what we're trying to do. For example, if you have a series of NAND gates, then for example you can do addition very quickly, or you know, things like that. For example, even a multiplication or division can happen with a series of NAND gates. Similarly, right, when you combine and have several sigmoid neurons, for example, in the form of a layered network, which is what is called as an artificial neural network. So you have an input layer which has a series of neurons and taking certain inputs, and then each layer is connected to the other layer by a series of weights, right? These are weighted connections. And then again, every neuron, either it fires, right? Or in the case of a sigmoid neuron, it gives a certain output value, and that output value goes as input to the next layer, right? And again, based on that would also be a sigmoid neuron, and that also gives certain output value. Similarly, it goes on to the output layer as well. So there are three layers typically, right? Traditional ANN comprises of three layers. Now the point is, so the idea is that the weights will actually learn. So the basically that's the learning that happens. So when you start with, for example, a prediction, right? The prediction is nothing but what output is given by the output layer sigmoid neurons. That essentially becomes a prediction of this entire network for this input, right? Whatever input you have given. So that is the output. Now, in the training phase, right? So typically, the training phase is when the network actually learns and all the weights get updated. So in the training phase, there is a teacher output. So this is a supervised learning. The teacher output is compared against the output of the network. So that's the whatever it was able to predict, compared against the teacher output. So what's the error? And this error is actually used to kind of adjust the weights in every layer. So there is a back propagation. So that's why it's called as a famous back propagation algorithm, which trains, right? So the weights from output layer to the hidden layer are all adjusted. So you saw three different layers, right? Yeah, so the once, you know, it goes all the way to the output layer, and then the teacher output is compared. And now the weights in the first two layers, the last two, right, between the output and the hidden layer, those weights are all compared. And those weights are all adjusted based on the delta that you saw, right? And again, this is taken to the next layer as well. So between the hidden and the input layers, those weights are also adjusted, again, based on this delta. So this is what is known as a backpropagation algorithm, and which was used to train an artificial neural network. So it used to work well for some of the nonlinear functions which people try to learn. So essentially what we are trying to do is you have some data, and essentially analytics is all about trying to understand patterns in the data, so that once you learn those patterns, when a new data comes in, you can make a prediction and say that, yes, this is how it will be, because I know based on the past, and of course I have learned patterns, so I can easily figure out what could happen, right? So that is what we're trying to do, right? So for certain things, the three-layer network will work. For example, the famous thing that is used is the digit recognition, handwritten digits, right? This data set is also commonly available and which is widely used in neural network literature. So people have built such networks, and so essentially this is the three-layer network which will recognize images which are handwritten images. So it will be able to recognize those images and letters essentially, or digits basically. So 0, 1 or whatever you write, right? The network will be able to identify, and it's basically a classification. So it'll classify into, for example, 0 or 1 or 2, whatever. So the output layer, whichever, whatever value it has, right? So for example, if 0 has a positive value, or if typically, since these are sigmoid neurons, right? So you will take the highest valued outputs and say that, okay, for example, if 9 had the highest value, so the input image was nothing but a 9, right? So that is how this whole thing works. Now the point is, what we are trying to do is, see, we just saw what's a brief view of